Greetings from Mesa View United Methodist Church of Albuquerque, New Mexico. We hope this message will be meaningful and relevant to your life and your relationship with God. We invite you to join us for worship on Sunday mornings. Our traditional service is at 8:30 a.m., and at 11 a.m. we gather for contemporary worship. More information may be found at our website, mesaviewumc.com. Now may you be blessed through the reading and hearing of God's holy word.
The epistle reading this morning comes from the book of Romans, chapter 14, beginning at verse 1. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain, and those who abstain must not pass judgment on those who eat. For God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall, and they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who observe the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. Also those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord, since they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or your sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then, each of us will be accountable to God. The Hebrew scripture reading today are selections from Proverbs. When pride comes, then comes disgrace, but wisdom is with the humble. Riches do not profit in the day of wrath, but righteousness delivers from death. Be assured, the wicked will not go unpunished, but those who are righteous will escape. The righteous know the needs of their animals, but the mercy of the wicked is cruel. The eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and the good. The Lord tears down the house of the proud, but maintains the widow's boundaries. Gray hair is a crown of glory, is gained in a righteous life. One who justifies the wicked and one who condemns the righteous are both alike an abomination to the Lord. Whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord and will be repaid in full. If you close your ear to the cry of the poor, you will cry out and not be heard. Do not rejoice when your enemies fall, and do not let your heart be glad when they stumble, or else the Lord will see it and be displeased and turn away his anger from them. Speak out for those who cannot speak, for the rights of all the destitute. Speak out, judge righteously, and defend the rights of the poor and the needy. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So in your bulletins, you'll find blue scripture insert, which has the scripture readings we just heard, but on the back is a place to write things to remember from today's service, so I invite you to take this out and make use of it during today's message. Remember some of the things you might need to remember as we go home today. Righteousness is one of those words we seem to only hear in church. I mean, there was the 80s surfer dude personified by Sean Penn as Jeff Spicoli would say things like, the waves were totally righteous. And we talk about people being self-righteous, that is, thinking themselves morally superior to other people. But about the only time we talk about righteousness itself is in church. I'm not sure exactly why that's the case, but today that's what we're going to be talking about as we have our penultimate sermon in our series on Proverbs, is what does Proverbs have to tell us about righteousness? But before we dig into the heart of that, I want to do something that's called a little pandering for that one verse that some of you chuckled about, which says that gray hair is the crown of glory that is gained in a righteous life. And so those of you who are trying to cover up that gray, you're covering up your righteousness. Or as Linda, my wife, likes to say, it's her wisdom highlights. Now, the truth is, just because you have gray hair doesn't mean you've actually led a righteous life, because Proverbs will also make it clear that, in the words of the immortal Buck Owens song, there is no fool like an old fool. Now, righteousness means different things in Scripture. In the Hebrew Scripture, it applies to something you earn because of your behavior. But it's more than just virtue or virtuous behavior. Instead, it's tied directly to covenantal relationships. So you can be righteous in your relationship with other humans, another person that you've entered into a covenantal agreement with, your spouse, a business partner, whoever it might be. And you can honor that covenantal relationship by doing the right things, upholding your ends of that agreement. By doing so, you are righteous. But in particular, righteousness in Scripture refers to the covenantal agreements that we've entered into, or the people of Israel entered into, with God. And one of the reasons why God is referred to as being righteous is because God always upholds God's side of the covenantal agreements. And so God is therefore always righteous. And so really it's up to us then, our actions, to try and maintain our side of the covenantal agreement. So works that we do that uphold that faithfulness to God are deemed righteous. And those that corrupt or violate that covenant agreement are considered unrighteous. While obeying the law is considered the standard for righteousness, it goes much beyond that. It also includes the teachings we get from the prophets, and as Jesus shows us, of seeing the depth of the law. So it's not just actually committing adultery. It's looking at somebody else with lust as a violation of the law. So righteousness on our parts is a reminder that we are in a covenantal relationship with God. And it's a two-sided relationship. God does works for us. God's upholding the side that God has promised to us. And we in turn are then called to uphold our side of that agreement. It's an active engagement by both parties. So that's why this is more than just about ethics or virtue, but about the entirety of the relationship that we hold with God and what we do to preserve that or to break that relationship. Now, that idea of righteousness extends into portions of the New Testament, in particular the Gospels. We are told that John the Baptist's parents lived blamelessly according to all the commandments and regulations of the Lord. That is, they were righteous. It's a similar thing that when we're told about Joseph of Arimathea, who takes Jesus off the cross and gives up his own tomb to bury Jesus in, he is said to be a good and righteous man. That is, he is an observant Jew. He follows the law of Israel. In Luke's gospel, at the cross, when the Roman centurion, some of you may remember, played immemorably by John Wayne, says, "Surely this man was innocent," says that of Christ. The Greek word there, translated usually as innocent, could also be translated as holy or righteous. Surely this man was righteous. He was doing the right things in the eyes of God. And although Jesus talks about righteousness some, he tells the disciples, he tells us, our righteousness must be greater than that of the scribes and the Pharisees. For the emphasis it receives within Judaism, he doesn't really talk about it all that much. And then there's a dramatic shift when we get into the later books of the New Testament, in particular Paul's letter, in particular Paul's letter to the Romans, which we'll be getting a new Bible study of that on Monday evening, starting tomorrow, if you would like to sign up for that. And Paul argues that righteousness is not a result of what we do, but instead something that's given to us by God. And he says if righteousness is something that we cause to bring on ourselves, and it could be something that we brag about, it's all our responsibility. Paul says that's not the way it works. And so he says that righteousness is given to us, or reckoned to us, is actually Paul's phrase, by God. So righteousness is not mediated through our actions, it's mediated through our faith. That God gives righteousness to the world through the person of Jesus Christ, seeking to bring back into right relation. Our response to Christ then is faith. And in that response to God of faith, then God reckons righteousness to us. This is part of Paul's argument that we are saved by faith alone. Or at least Martin Luther's interpretation of Paul's argument that we are saved by faith alone, which we as Protestants hold on to. So it is God's action through Christ that delivers righteousness to the world, and we receive righteousness through our response of faith. Paul also argues that righteousness is found in conjunction with wisdom, and so he builds on this tradition of the wisdom literature, in particular of Proverbs that we've been looking at, in the sense of understanding God's wisdom for the world. So a quick then recap. We have righteousness that's earned by us because of our obeying the covenantal relationship and then supporting and uplifting the covenantal relationship we have with God. And it's also God's gift to us because of the gift of Christ. Now, for the sake of Proverbs of understanding righteousness, we need to go with that Jewish understanding of the covenantal relationship and upholding that. And that understanding of righteousness is important because if you notice the passages we heard this morning from Proverbs, which only touches on a few of them, there's huge numbers of Proverbs about righteousness. Since it is part of wisdom literature and about choosing the right path, it's about the actions that we do. Not all of them, but most of them. And that's true actually for most of the Proverbs. If you do this, this is going to happen to you, Proverbs say. But this also this sense of action, because righteousness is part of upholding that covenantal relationship, of saying to God, you are in charge of my life, of being faithful. And some of it is clearly tied up with salvation issues as well. So Proverbs says, be assured, the wicked will not go unpunished, but those who are righteous will escape. Now, we don't have time or the inclination on my part to sort of go into a Jewish understanding of the afterlife or final judgment, but from a Christian understanding, we know what that means. That there will be a final judgment at some point in time. That God knows our hearts. God clearly knows our actions which follow from our hearts. And so following, then the Proverbs reminds us, the eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and the good. Nothing is hidden from God. And so those times of us we want to say, well, if God really knew what I did, he wouldn't forgive me, sort of blocks this out. God is there in every place and every time. But when we remember, again, this is about a covenantal relationship, it's not just about judgments or punishments. It's about upholding our side of the agreements. That when we are baptized, we take vows. The covenantal relationship with God. And God is always faithful to those, and so God is righteous. And so it's up to us to uphold our side, to be faithful as well. And even some of the things that we see or hold up as signs of faithfulness, things that Proverbs wants to hold up as signs of faithfulness occasionally, like material wealth, it turns out those are not a get-out-of-jail-free card. Because we hear, riches do not profit in a day of wrath, but righteousness delivers from death. So it doesn't matter how much money you have, what your possessions are, what car you drive, what job you have, your positions of power or authority, how many friends you've had, how many times your team has won the World Series. None of those things ultimately matter. It's about the life that you've lived. Did you live a life of righteousness so that everything you did was pleasing to God and honored God's name? So this week, my wife Linda had a job interview, and the person she was meeting for the interview was coming from a different area of town, so they sort of decided to meet in the middle at the Starbucks in the uptown area. And I do have permission to tell this story, just so you're aware. And as she was driving into the parking lot, she saw a car coming the other way, and they were sort of both going for the same parking space, and the other car was closer, and so she sped up in order to get into it first. And she said, as I was pulling into the spot, I thought to myself, I really hope the other person in that car is not the one I'm supposed to be meeting. And sure enough, it was. Although she didn't know that until after the interview was over and she saw him go out to get into his car. And of course, when she told me that, after I was done laughing, I said, glorify God in all that you do. And she said, glorify God? I didn't even glorify myself in that moment. And then she asked me if she should apologize in sort of an unrighteous moment for myself. I said, well, do you think that he knew that it was you who took that space? And she said, no, I don't think he did. I said, then don't say anything to him. And she did it. She was offered the job, by the way. But if we think about righteousness as being in right relationship with God and with others, about doing everything to glorify God's name, to glorify our name for God, then it's really hard to live that out, because righteousness is hard because we're alive. That's basically it. So just as wisdom begins with bowing down to God, of fearing God, being in awe and reverence of God, what also leads to that wisdom is being in a position of humility. When pride comes, then comes disgrace. We say this now as pride goes before the fall. But wisdom is with the humble. As soon as you start to think yourself better than others, you're going down the wrong path. And it's not being proud of who you are, your accomplishments, the things you've done, the gifts and graces that God has given to you. It's not about trying to put those down, but instead about thinking ourselves superior to others, that what we've done is better than what others have done. Because then we're on the path to destruction, Proverbs says. Pope Gregory the Great, who's responsible for the propagation of the seven deadly sins, actually said the sin of pride was the worst of all the sins, because not only could it cause us to forget about God or think that God was not necessary, but it's pride that leads us to all the other sins. Because it's pride that leads us to thinking about others and about God in the right way. And even if we take care about what we are told about how to be righteous, what we see in Proverbs is righteousness comes from how people treat others. Not how they treat people who are like them, not people how they treat people who are above them in some hierarchical scale, people who have more power or authority or more money who might give them benefits they might otherwise get, but it's how they treat people who are below them. People who don't have a voice. Pay attention to how others treat waiters in a restaurant. That says who they are. That's what Proverbs is telling us. So we remember, Proverbs is written for wealthy young men who will have positions in the royal court, who will be leading Israel. So Proverbs is saying, pay attention to how you treat others, especially those who might be lower than you are. So Proverbs says, the righteous know the needs of their animals, but the mercy of the wicked is cruel. So while animals can communicate their needs somewhat to us, for the most part, they have no voice. They get what we give to them. They receive what we give to them, either good or bad. And so the righteous, Proverbs says, know the needs of their animals. They don't treat them as an end to their own means. They treat them as blessings and an end in and of themselves. That's made more explicit later on when we're told, if you close your ear to the cry of the poor, you will cry out and not be heard. Now, we hear several times of people crying out in Scripture to God, God, hear my cry. The best example of that is people in slavery in Egypt. The reason Moses is sent, he said, I've heard the people's cry, and I'm sending you to set them free. But here we're told that if we want to have our cries heard and God respond, we must first hear the cries of others who are in need. It's like when Jesus says that to be forgiven, we must forgive. To have God hear our cries, we have to hear the cries of others. But it's more than just listening to their cries. It's also doing something about it. Speak out for those who cannot speak, for the rights of the destitute. Speak out, judge righteously, defend the rights of the poor and the needy. Give voice to the voiceless. Speak out on their behalf and judge rightly on their behalf. There are lots of cries for injustice taking place in our society. Just think of the riots that are taking place in St. Louis. Much of that is, hear our cry of what's happening in our communities. It's not just injustice against individuals, it's also laws and systems and institutions that bring about injustice. Proverbs says we have to listen to those cries. It doesn't mean you initially have to agree with them, but you have to listen to them. Stop giving excuses, stop talking, listen to what they're actually saying. And just because it doesn't affect you doesn't mean it's not a problem or it's not a reality in their life, even if it's not a reality in yours. Which then I think leads into the injunction that we need to hear in this day, because I think it's one of the major shortfalls we have taking place, and it's true of everyone around us. And that is, Proverbs says, one who justifies the wicked and one who condemns the righteous are both like an abomination to the Lord. And there's a tendency to attack people in groups who don't belong to us. And then to defend the same behavior in our own group that we've just attacked in somebody else. So, for example, when Alex Rodriguez played for the New York Yankees, Red Sox fans were quick to call him out for cheating for taking steroids. Rightfully so. He broke the laws, the rules of baseball. But similarly, they just went ahead and cheered David Ortiz, their star player, who they conveniently overlooked the fact that he failed the steroid test. So we're going to attack a player on another team, but we're going to support our own. That's justifying the wicked. And we do that in all areas of life. We do it in politics in particular. A Republican congressman this past week was recorded as saying, well, the president's a blankety-blank. He didn't say blankety-blank. But he's our blankety-blank, right? People do that on the other side of the aisle, too. We justify behavior for our tribal group while castigating the same behavior on the other side. Or we say people on the other side are just wrong on everything. We can't even imagine where they might be right. And so we condemn righteousness on the other side and justify wickedness on our own side. We justify the actions on our behalf because they're us while condemning others. And often we hold this position. This is what Paul is talking about in his letter to the Romans. We hold this position. It's an argument of the righteous versus the sinners. When in fact it's an argument of the sinners versus the sinners. We all fall short of the glory of God. So if we want to get past the partisan gridlock that we currently find ourselves in. We have to learn to praise those on the opposite team and to say, that's a really good idea. Maybe there's something there. And more importantly, we have to be willing to call out people on our own team when they're doing something wrong. Praise when praise is due on all sides, and criticism when criticism is due on all sides. That we don't allow tribalism to overcome our injunction to do the right thing. Which leads into the final point, sort of builds on this, and that is, do not rejoice when your enemies fall, and do not let your heart be glad when they stumble, or else the Lord will see it and be displeased and turn away his anger from them. Just like that last one, this one's hard. Because when somebody you don't like stumbles and falls, it's really easy to gloat. And we want to be, look what God did to them. They're getting their just rewards. So I can say I love the days when the Yankees win and the Red Sox lose. Those are good days in our house. I don't root for injuries for the Red Sox. Actually, I want them at full strength so they can't have any excuses when they get the snot beat out of them. It makes the gloating even so much better. But it's wrong, and Jesus tells us, pray for your enemies. Pray for your enemies, not because it's easy, but because it's hard. Because the path that leads to destruction is wide and easy, but the path that leads to eternal life is narrow. Hard. And when we begin to pray for our enemies, not for their downfall, we find that our prayers don't change them, they change us. That our attitudes towards them begin to change. How we see them and how we see ourselves is transformed. Now, what this proverb actually says is don't gloat about it, because then God might stop doing what God's doing to them. I don't think that's good theology, but if that's what you need to tell yourself in order to keep you from gloating about it, that's what you need to do. But a better place is to simply to see them as a brother or sister, as a beloved child of God, and be upset about that calamity as we would be upset about a calamity in our friends' lives. So righteousness is about living in right relationship with God, and about living in right relationship with each other. It's not about what we believe or don't believe, but about what we do and what we don't do. Are we practicing gentleness and forgiveness? Are we showing love and kindness, patience and self-control? Are we offering joy and peace? Are we being faithful? Are we doing the things of the fruits of the Spirit? Because when we exhibit faithfulness to God, then we will exhibit faithfulness to the world. We will exhibit righteousness. And we don't do it because it's easy. We do it because it's hard. Because we are called to do something different in the world. So Proverbs again says there's two paths you get to choose to follow. Path of wisdom and righteousness, and the path of folly or wickedness. The choice is ours. May we practice and live faithfulness and righteousness. I pray that it will be so, my brothers and sisters.